All right, so I think we should be live. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Thomas Metzger, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of all the organizers to this small series of webinars prior to our workshop on the ultra-fast antiferromagnetic writing on the 9th and 10th of May next week. Together with our colleagues from Prague, St. Petersburg, Mainz and Nijmegen, our goal was to bring together the leading experts in the field, and we wanted to review the state of the art and discuss present challenges. The ultimate goal here is to identify the next steps to eventually initiate a breakthrough towards the fastest and least dissipative writing of antiferromagnetic bits. Stimulate participation of early stage researchers in the workshop. We organized this mini webinar series of online lectures by experts in closely related but already established fields. Lectures on theory of antiferromagnetism, ultrafast magnetism, and antiferromagnetic spintronics. As well, we will meet editor of Nature Nanotechnology. These lectures are given prior to our next week's conference and hosted in the same fashion as the prestigious SPICE SpinBlast X seminar series. So around 1 hour of talk, followed by some time reserved explicitly for questions. I would like to thank the whole SPICE team, and in particular, Professor Jairo Sinova and Elena Hilp. Since the lectures are organized in a Zoom webinar format, all the attendees are muted. And to ask a question, please just raise your hand or write in the Q&A. Your questions will be either addressed to the speaker, or you can ask them directly after being promoted to a panelist. Please keep also in mind that all the talks will be live streamed on the SPICE YouTube channel, and they will be made available later. We start the series of lectures today with the theory of magnetic order, and in particular antiferromagnetic order, by Professor Ivanov. On Tuesday and Friday at the same time, there will be lectures given by Alexei Kimmel and Thomas Jungwirth on ultrafast magnetism and antiferromagnetic spintronics. And at a different time on Thursday, Dr. Benjamin Heinrich provides seminar to meet senior editor of Nature Nanotechnology. That being said, it is my very great pleasure to welcome Professor Ivanov and thank him already for kindly accepting our invitation to provide his lecture. Professor Ivanov is a member of the National Academy of Sciences in Ukraine, and I think for many people in magnetism research, and especially in antiferromagnetism research, he is well known as an outstanding expert already over decades. To briefly introduce him, he graduated in 1972 from the Maxim Gorky State University in Kharkov in Ukraine. He received 2 years later there also his PhD, and he became senior research fellow in Kharkov as well at the Low Temperature Physics Institute. Then he moved on to Kiev to become chief research fellow at the Institute of Magnetism. To point out a few of his research interests, it's quite a broad field: solitons and condensed matter, theory of magnetic domain structures, macroscopic quantum effects, and magnetic nanoparticles. He received many, many awards. Lately, 2015, he became distinguished referee of the American Physical Society. He received the Davidoff Prize in 2005, and he's board member of experts in condensed matter physics. That only given as a brief introduction, I will stop share my screen, and I would like to ask Professor Ivanov to please go ahead and start talk whenever you like.
Hello to everybody. I hope you can see my screen.
Is it seen? Not yet. You have to share the screen yet. We see you, but not the screen yet.
Well, not in principle. Oops, yeah. Find.
It should be a green bottom at the green.
I just pressed this button.
And another possibility, Boris, is that you can leave Zoom and come back in, and then we can promote you. Maybe it resets itself better. That's also a possibility.
Just before we saw my screen, so if something
slips,
I'll try to close all the windows. Maybe. Oh, I don't know what happened. What happened? It was this program right in me.
Okay. Do you want to maybe the best thing is for you to leave Zoom and come back in? I think that would work, and then we'll promote you to panelist again. Do you want to do that? That usually works.
Now it's
coming back. Okay. Great.
Let me just make it full screen.
Full screen, yeah, controller.
Full screen, yeah.
Yeah.
It's okay now, right?
Very good. Go ahead.
If it's okay, I would like to say what I am happy to be here to present my talk. And I would like to say what I like it if you're among us very much. And I'm working in this field for a long time, but it's again my pleasure to discuss it.
I'm sorry, Boris, can I interrupt you for a second? I am sorry, but I think the speaker that you have selected is the one of the computer, not the one that you have on the phone. If you don't mind, on the speaker itself, can you click on there should be an arrow pointing up that shows you what is selected for the speaker? And see if you have the correct selection for the
The same. I did not change anything.
So yeah, but I think that was the wrong setting to begin with. I think if you, I'm suspecting that we are hearing a lot of echo because you are using the microphone of the laptop, not of the one that you have on your headpiece. Do you know how to look for that?
And what? How is now?
Now it's much better. Yeah,
much better. Okay, so I can stop. I can begin once more. So the only this is a short talk, the theory of anti-Karamazov. I would like to add two corrections. First of all, it's not all the theory; it's all the phenomenological theory. First, and second, I would say, what now I am very interested in some other magnets, Fieri magnets, nearly compensated Fieri magnets, which are also interesting for spintronics and for some other application. And I will speak about not anti-ferromagnet only, but also a Fieri magnet. This is some short outlook. First, I'll discuss some simple picture, who is anti-ferromagnets, who is ferromagnets, who is ferromagnets. Then I will discuss some static energy, which will be necessary for explanation why dynamics in anti-ferromagnet is so fast. Then I will discuss the next part, third,
is the main part because I will discuss the difference in Landau-Lifshitz equation for ferromagnets and sigma model equation for antiferromagnets. And also I will discuss how to generalize a sigma model for antiferromagnets for description of ferrimagnets, which are nearly in compensation. And then it, the fourth part is free, some application of sigma model with demonstration how nicely it's working. And some of them are old, some of them are new, some of them are trivial. So let's go. First of all, I'll start with some textbook pictures because people told me what it will be some students here. And I would like to remind you some textbook pictures. What, who is ferromagnets, who is antiferromagnets, and what is ferrimagnets. For ferromagnets, usually people consider some lattice of spins. Atoms are equivalent, and spins are oriented parallelly because of exchange interaction, which have a special sign and orient also spin parallel. And here there is, we can say about spin ordering or magnetization, it's the same because these two quantities, mean value of spin on the, and magnetization are connected, but very simple connection. G is G factor, which can be usually is considered as equal to 2, but some deviation plus minus 10% are also possible. Concerning antiferromagnets. The same picture, the same equivalent atoms in the lattice, but the difference is in the sign of exchange interaction. And this exchange interaction prefer to have nearest spins to be antiparallel. It's some special situation. You can say what in antiferromagnet, the half of atoms have the parallel orientation of spin and another half have this as well parallel orientation, but anti-parallel to the first part, to sublattice, first sublattice and second sublattice. What is important? Yes, and ferrimagnets as well have some anti-ferromagnetic exchange interaction. The spins of atoms are anti-parallel, but for ferrimagnets, sublattices, as well there is sublattices, but the sublattices are not equivalent. And I would say what that is a very important point. Full equivalence or non-equivalence of sublattices. Because in principle, for ferrimagnet, you can have some compensation, but you have different spins here. You have different atoms here. G-factors can be different. And for this reason, if magnetization of sublattices have a different dependence on the temperature, in principle, it can be compensation of the sublattices. But it can be compensation of magnetization or compensation of mean value of spin. And they can be in different points. What is important for antiferromagnet? What just in the definition of antiferromagnet is necessary to say what in the crystal group, there is some element which replaces sublattices. They should be completely equivalent from the viewpoint of crystal group. And these odd elements, these elements which replace sublattices, 1 to 2 and 2 to 1, are called odd elements. And the presence of at least one odd element is the definition of antiferromagnets. Make the difference between antiferromagnet and ferrimagnet. What I can say a little bit beyond textbook pictures. Usually, if you consider ferromagnet, you image some single element ferromagnet like metallic iron, nickel, cobalt, and so on. But in principle, you can have ferromagnet not without lattice, because very well known are so-called metallic glasses ferromagnetic based on iron. You can have some alloys like permalloy, whereas two different items of iron and nickel. The point is what for permalloy, the spins, the exchange interaction between iron and nickel is such that the spins are parallel. For ferrimagnet, the situation is as the following. As well, that is not necessary. Some ferrimagnets have well-defined lattice. For example, yttrium iron permit or radio permits. But in principle, it is not necessary because you can have some amorphous ferrimagnet like famous gadolinium iron cobalt. You have some alloy. In principle, it can be some amorphous alloy, and also you can have some different concentration of gadolinium, and after that you can have some compensation point. You can manipulate this compensation point. Again, it will be compensation point of spin and magnetic moment, and these points are differs like 50 K or something like that. But as well, for antiferromagnet, you have to have well-defined crystal lattice, because in principle, it could be considered some amorphous antiferromagnet, but it's very complicated stuff and it cannot be reduced to this simple to sublattice picture. And also, I would say, what the L vector is something very specific. Because you can consider L vector and you can consider magnetization. Magnetization is the usual vector, like say magnetic. And magnetization transforms after all the transformation, including time reversal, as well as in the same way as magnetic. So it can be coupled to magnetic. The product M by H is invariant and so on and so on. It is not the case for nail vector or antiferromagnetic vector because it's very specific object because it can change its sign under the action of odd symmetry. So excuse me, I have some pictures here for demonstration of specific role of crystalline structure, but I have to skip them and go to the next, because I estimate what it's too much, it will be too long. So why we are interested in this ferrimagnet or antiferromagnet? It's because of new developing region of physics of magnet domains, like femtomagnetism, terahertz spintronic, and so on. The point is what for both materials, antiferromagnet and ferrimagnet, near the compensation, we have some enhancement or an fasting of the spin dynamics. And this is very useful to have these materials if you are need to go to higher frequencies, higher speed of magnetic solitons, higher speed of domain walls, higher speed of magnons, and so on and so on. And antiferromagnetic spin dynamics is also quite specific. The basis for this dynamics is so-called sigma model. I will discuss it a little bit later, but now I will say what L, the snail vector, difference of sublattice spins, is the principal variable. And the sigma model is writing down only for this L vector. And S, mean value of spins, the sum of the spins of sublattice, is a slave variable. In principle, we can work with this set of equations, Landau-Lifshitz of two Landau-Lifshitz equations for S1 and S2 for sublattice, but much more convenient is to use sigma. Let's discuss a little bit what kind of spin dynamics we will have. Again, I was asked to make this talk for students. Landau-Lifshitz equation, which is writing down here, is a very well known equation is magnets. And here you have, it is present in a standard way through magnetization. Here is a so-called effective field, which was introduced by Landau and Lifshitz as a variation of the energy or functional of the energy. And also you have two terms, Hilbert damping. Landau-Lifshitz have a little bit different form of damping term in their equation, and spin transfer torque, which was introduced in the end of the past century by Slonczewski and Berger. This equation is a basis for description of many effects including spintronics, for ferromagnets. What we can say about dynamic of spin, because the main point is how to spin, move, how, what is the dynamics of spin. It is clear, for this equation is a clear equation for precession. And in fact, if you consider some linear oscillation of the magnetic moment, this oscillation is nothing but a precession around the this effective field. For example, for uniaxial ferromagnet, it is just precession around the Z axis. And for describe ferromagnet, you have to have these terms. Let me explain. First term is non-uniform exchange, which is only exchange term present for ferromagnet. Then you have anisotropy energy, and then you have the Zeeman term, interaction of magnetization with external magnetic field H0. I would like to stress that Landau-Lifshitz equation conserve the learn for the magnetization MS, and for this reason I can rewrite it for the unit vector. And here I just stress it by using both magnetization, which is convenient in this Zeeman energy, or this exchange and anisotropy. In principle, as I say, antiferromagnet can be described in the ground of two magnetization of the set of two Landau-Lifshitz equations. And many people in some discussion, formal or non-formal, told me sometimes, what I don't like the sigma model, it's complicated, it's better to solve just this set of equations. I would like to stress that sigma model have nothing mystical. And the sigma model is just one step of the solution of the set of equations. And to explain that, let me say, let's rewrite our Landau-Lifshitz equation, set of Landau-Lifshitz equation, not from through spins as one of the two, but through so-called irreducible representation of the group of translation of sublattices. In principle, it's some mathematical complicated words, but in principle, it's very easy, sum and difference. If you replace sublattices, magnetization still be unchanged, and the NL vector change its sign. As well, I can introduce the same vectors for ferromagnet, but it's sublattices are not. Our deal, our goal is to rewrite equation for L vector only. And in advance, I can say, but for antiferromagnet, this kind of equation, just replacement of L vector in Landau-Lifshitz equation, is impossible because of the symmetry consideration. You see, what here you have magnetization field. And under the time reversal, magnetization changes sign, and this term is unchanged, and this term is also unchanged. Everything is okay. But here you have one more possibility to change the sign of L vector. So for this reason, this kind of equation is completely forbidden for antiferromagnet, but in principle, something like that can appear for ferromagnet. And also to write down a Landau-Lifshitz equation, from Landau-Lifshitz equation sigma model, we need to discuss what kind of energy are involved in phenomenological description of antiferromagnet. It's a little bit more such energies, such terms, than for ferromagnet. As you remember, for ferromagnet, you have two only non-uniform exchange. But here you have uniform. You have product of two spins, two sublattice spins, and it can be reduced to this form. Also, you have non-uniform exchange, Zeeman term, and so on, but let's now discuss exchange. Uniform exchange, which is completely absent from ferromagnet. All the terms in this density, functional is, contain some density. And all the terms here have a coefficient it is convenient to present through the following way, some effective field, which demonstrate us the strength of this interaction, and some lattice magnetization. And the dimension is okay, early G to centimeter cubic. And what is this exchange field? This exchange field is connected to the exchange integral. So it's in terms of temperature, it can be something like 1,000 Kelvin. So it's huge value of the exchange field. Exchange field is of the order of some megahertz. And in our Earth, there is no such source of a field. Only in the universe you can find some such strange, huge fields in the surface of neutron star. It could be 20, 50, 40 megahertz in the surface of neutron star after the collapse of usual star. So these fields cannot be obtained in the Earth, but it can be only because it's some kind of effective field inside the antiferromagnet. So in antiferromagnet, you are dealing with some huge field, and this huge field can, in principle, work. And as we will see, it is working. And in it enhance some frequencies, limit speeds, and so on and so on. Also, in antiferromagnet, in antiferromagnet, you have magnetic anisotropy, of course. And this magnetic anisotropy has the same structure as for ferromagnet with the same crystal group. You have, of course, the Emanuel energy. But in antiferromagnet, you have one more contribution, which is very non-trivial, so-called Zelashinsky-Morey interaction, DMI. And this Zelashinsky-Morey interaction also can be rewritten in this form with some Zelashinsky field HD, but is again as an exchange field, is effective field which depends on the direction of vector A. Generally, Zelashinsky-Morey interaction in linear only over magnetization and linear cubic curve power over the vector L, and this is non-trivial symmetry which can produce such invariance. And for this reason, for the presence of the Zelashinsky-Morey field and usual Zeeman field, external field, magnetization can be non-zero in antiferromagnet. It is easy to find, minimizing the energy over this magnetization. It is easy to find what the magnetic moment or this M, small vector, normalized vector, can be present in the following form. And you can see what here you have effective field, like a field, external field or Zelashinsky field, derived by exchange field. So for any reasonable field, like, for example, here in University of Nijmegen, there is some source of high magnetic like half of megahertz. But for this reasonable field, this magnetic moment of antiferromagnet is small forever. It can be small, but it can be present even in the ground state because of the Zelashinsky-Morey interaction, but it is small. And let's discuss some examples of model antiferromagnets to explain why is this Zelashinsky-Morey interaction can be present, and what is the form of Zelashinsky-Morey interaction. I would like to say many people are writing down Zelashinsky-Morey interaction in this form, like cross product of M and L. It is true, but not all the time. And to explain that, let's consider one concrete example, so-called ortoferrite. People call it ferrite, but in principle, this is antiferromagnet. You see here some green circles with plus and minus. It is the difference of lattices. And let me explain the structure of this antiferromagnet. You can see what y-axis, if you rotate, this is three axes of the second kind. And if you rotate around y-axis, sublattices 1-to-1, 2-to-2, and so on. So sublattices are not replaced. For this reason, y-axis is even. And other two axes, x and z, are odd. And if you look carefully to the transformation of the component of magnetization and L vector, you will see what magnetization is transforms in a standard way after the rotation around x axis. But L simultaneously changes sign. Lx and Ly stay the same, Lz stay the same, Lx changes sign. And after doing that, you can easily find, just probing all the combination of these vectors, you can find what the Leschinsky-Moria interaction can be present in this way, with d1 and d3 being different constants. And in orthospherites, these constants are a little bit different. Leschinsky had demonstrated that in 56, 58 for different magnet. I would say what it's very non-trivial contribution to the energy, because it was necessary to have 20 years from the beginning of investigation of anti-ferromagnets to find this invariance. And Moria made very important contribution to this theory. Moria considered two spins connected by vector n, and he found what if you account for exchange direction and spin orbital direction for these spins, you will find this kind of term. Without any symmetry and so on, you can find this term. He called it anti-symmetric exchange, and he connected it to the Leschinsky energy, which was found a little bit before. And what is important here, what this anti-symmetric form, through spins, as Moria wrote, or through M and L, as written here, have the coefficient with effective field, which is exchange relativistic. It involves simultaneous exchange field and the spin orbit field. And for this reason, this field is high enough. For example, for orthoferrite is 150 kHz. This is some other examples, or excuse me. And here, this is anisotropy. Anisotropy is the same for any biaxial magnets. It can be ferromagnet, antiferromagnet, ferrimagnet, doesn't matter. Some other examples. This is iharbite with third order axis. It is odd. It is even, sorry. And for this reason, the only Leschinsky contribution is all this. And the little bit different is some fluorides, manganese fluoride, nickel fluoride, and some other. For them, principal axis, C4, is odd. And for this reason, you have plus here. It's a big difference for the magnetic moment. For all the system, you have no magnetic moment along the principal axis. It is clear. But also for this way, you have some anisotropic magnet. Here you have is isotropic magnetic moment if L is lying in the easy plane. And here you have strongly anisotropic magnetic moment. It's equal to zero for two directions, or four directions for two axes. And this asymmetry of the Leschinsky-Moria interaction manifests itself in some spin orientation transition. In principle, anisotropy constant can be temperature dependent, and sometimes they are temperature dependent. They can change their sign, and what leads to some reorientation. For example, for hematite, so-called Morian transition is very well known. And if you have some high temperatures, L vector is in the basal plane, it is easy plane magnet, and magnetization is also non-zero, weak magnetic moment, counting of sublattices, and it is also in the basal plane. And for low temperatures, below 260 K, okay, you have easy axial interferomagnet, and in that case you have zero lead magnetic moment. The same is valid for orthoferrite. For orthoferrites, we know a lot of different phase transitions. For the same Molin point for dysprosium orthoferrite, and more complicated picture of the 2 second order phase transition. For other, some other radio of orthoferrites, and near this phase transition, you have to consider complicated form of magnetic anisotropy. If K2 can go to zero, leading to the phase transition, K4 comes into play. Return to spin dynamics. Now we know all the interactions, which are writing down here. And we know the scales, corresponding scales. We know what magnetization is. This reduced magnetization, normalized magnetization, small, but have a huge coefficient. Then you have some Zeeman and Zelashinsky term with magnetic moment. And then you have anisotropy and non-uniform exchange. And I would say what it's more or less obvious, but it's not necessary to add some non-uniform exchange or anisotropy, which depends on the magnetization of this magnetic moment, of this normalized magnetic moment. Normalized magnetic moment cannot exceed 1%, so we don't need to include 1% squared corrections. And that simplifies the analysis in very strong way. Because if you look for this first equation with one star, you will see what the all of this equation have contribution of the uniform exchange. This L cross M. Some other terms have the same structure, L, M, linear structure, but have a much smaller coefficient. For this reason, from this first equation, you have only the simple computation. And after that, you can easily present normalized magnetic moment, magnetization, through the L only. And this equation is very simple. It does not contain any gradients or some other contributions. It's very simple. Here I wrote this general equation. You have exchange direction, and this term is present for antiferromagnet and ferrimagnets both. And here, nu is proportional to the difference of spins, and this contribution is only present for ferrimagnets. For ferrimagnets, magnetic moment is a little bit more complicated, but I don't like to discuss it in more details now. Now we can, so again, from this first equation, which looks like as long equation as the second one, from this first equation, I can just find very simple formula for M. And then I can take it and put the second equation, and I'll have this generalized sigma model. I wrote it here. Because, look, here you have contribution common to Landau-Lipschitz equation, which is present only for ferrimagnet. For antiferromagnet, it's forbidden by sigma. And this term, this is sigma model for antiferromagnet. And also, I wrote it with inclusion of Gilbert term as well and spin pumping, because these terms have the same form as for magnetization in Landau-Lipschitz as well. The anisotropy contribution is the same as for Landau-Lipschitz. The only difference is this. Oh, well, okay. This is also gradient of gradient squared of L vector is the same as under the variation of magnetization. The only difference is the second time derivative of L instead of first time derivative for ferrimagnet or Landau-Lipschitz. And you can easily see what you, if you put dm dt here through this L, you will just get the second time derivative. And also what is important here, you have a combination, second time derivative minus gradient squared. And this combination is very, very well familiar for the people who knows some relativistic field theory or relativistic dynamics is Lorentz invariant combination. And this gives me the possibility to rewrite it in Lorentz invariant form by introducing some Vm, magnon velocity, Vm. Later we will see how this Vm appears, how it looks like. And well, this is exactly some formal Lorentz invariant, which is very easy and very transparent for some analysis. And let's discuss this coefficient. First of all, I would say, what here is exchange frequency. And if we wrote the expression for this magnon velocity, some analogy of light velocity for relativistic mechanics, it only contains some exchange terms, non-uniform exchange, which is something like exchange integral multiplied by a squared, a is lattice constant. This non-uniform, only exchange terms. And for this reason, this velocity is high. As I told you, or not told you, but I'll do that, it's some kilometers per second, it's 20 kilometers per second for all of you, right? Also, you can see, what here are the same term for anisotropy. As for Landau Lift, M D anisotropy DM for ferromagnet, L DL for antiferromagnet. But here you have omega squared. And here you have exchange frequency. For this reason, the frequency of antiferromagnetic resonance is not anisotropy frequency or anisotropy field as for ferromagnet, but square root from anisotropy field and exchange field. This is the case how this exchange field, this huge exchange field, come into play. And I will say what even having no derivation, what I made before with some two Landau-Lift equations and so on, even with not doing this derivation, I can predict the form of this equation. Because look, first order derivative is forbidden. So the only way to do something is to write down second order, second time derivative. Second time derivative have to have some frequency. What kind of frequency can be? The only exchange frequency is antiferromagnetic. In isotropic case, it's same. So it can be predicted. And this sigma model equation can be written, we derive sigma model equation by use Landau-Lift equation. But a little bit later, half of year later, Andreev and Marchenko present the same Landau sigma model equation without any use of Landau-Lift equation, just from the symmetry. So for Landau-Lift equation, you have this term. You have relativistic frequency and exchange relativistic for antiferromagnet for sigma model. You have exchange relativistic magnon speed for ferromagnet. And you have exactly exchange for antiferromagnet. So everything is enhanced or enfasted by presence of exchange interaction. It's a limit of antiferromagnet if nu is equal. It is more or less clear what if nu, this parameter uncompensation, which is S1 minus S2 for sublattices, is non-zero but small. And the same will be valid for ferrimagnet. But ferrimagnet is more convenient from some viewpoint of, say, sample preparation, the same as for permalloy. You can just use some evaporation of amorphous alloys and so on and so on. So let now discuss the last part. Now go to last part of my talk. We have this nice sigma model equation. I did not discuss how to excite, for example, dynamics of L vector by use of spin polarized current, because it probably will be done in one of the next lectures. I also don't discuss the Stilper-Dumper term because it's trivial. And now let's go to the description of the form of some dynamical states for antiferromagnets. Here you have some sample, antiferromagnetic sample, and ferromagnet. I just use the same picture for them. And also let's consider simple case of uniaxial anisotropy and even easy axial anisotropy. For ferromagnet and antiferromagnet, the form is the same, and the value of this anisotropy field in principle are very common because of the common origin of these two terms for antiferromagnet and ferromagnet. And here I wrote N, unit vector N to stress. But if you replace N by normalized magnetization for ferromagnet, and you also can replace it by antiferromagnet, you will have the same anisotropy energy. But the dynamics is completely different. First of all, easy axial magnet. For easy axial ferromagnet, you have nothing but just precession with some frequency, which is determined by anisotropy. For antiferromagnet, so you have one magnon moment. For antiferromagnet, you have two moments. And if you have uniaxial antiferromagnet, these two moments can be linearly polarized in orthogonal direction, and they are degenerated. So for this reason, you also can consider right-hand rotation and left-hand rotation. You can have some circularly polarized modes with different helicity. For only one helicity, which is determined by direction of the field for ferromagnet, and two different helicities for antiferromagnetic magnet. In principle, it is common, not exactly the same as for light, and you can say what this antiferromagnetic magnet can be in three polarization, linear, right-hand rotation, left-hand circular, right-hand circular, so we can have some spin. But it's just an analogy, have no some deep sense in that. And if you have biaxial antiferromagnet, you will have only linear polarization, and the frequency of these two modes are different. By the way, if you have axial ferromagnet, you still have one mode, and just the frequency will be square root from these two anisotropy field corresponding to these two directions. Let me say a few words. In the derivation of sigma model, when we're doing that, we did not miss important information. If you have one Landau Lift equation, you have 1 degree of. If you have two, you have 2 degrees. And this Hamilton structure still be the same if we go from two Landau-Lifshitz equation to one sigma model. The number of degree of freedom still to be two. We did not miss any degree of freedom. We did not miss any kind of dynamics. The only what we are missing some unimportant terms. For example, if you write down exact Landau-Lifshitz equation, two set of two Landau-Lifshitz equations, you also can solve them. And you will find, again, some exchange multiplied by anisotropy. But for different modes, it can be exchange plus some other anisotropy. But adding up anisotropy to exchange have no sense. It's very small correction. So if we are going to this sigma model equation, we just remove all unimportant terms and make our equations simpler. Again, some uniform dynamics. And now let's discuss a little bit uniform in space, nonlinear dynamics. Y sigma model equation is very convenient here. The reason is very simple. You have some simple mechanical analogy. Your nail vector is unit vector. So it, I can image it as some particle, massive particle. The mass is deriving from this exchange field and so on. This massive particle moving along the surface of the sphere. It can be easily solved. For uniaxial case, it's a solvable problem of mechanics. And it can be easily solved in angular variables. And this is some simple mechanical analogy. You can simply show some integral of motion. So what is one more important? Even for crystals with low crystalline symmetry, like biaxial crystals, sometimes dynamics of vector L is planar. So the same as I show here, linear polarization, planar dynamic of vector L. But here it was in linear case. Here in non-linear case, it's also present. It's also present. It's never can be present for ferromagnets. By the way, in ferromagnet as well, but for antiferromagnet, it can be present. And in this case, you have some drastic simplification of the problem because you have only one variable. You can some simple mechanical equation, just 1D motion with some force or in some potential relief. And even if you have some complicated potential relief, like, say, near the phase transition, reorientation phase transition, where you have to contribution of different anisotropies. You can easily present this graph of this and analyze how this massive particle is moving within this potential relief. So for uniform in space, nonlinear motion, sigma model equation gives you some nice, transparent, and obvious picture, which is going to our intuition in mechanics, what we got in school. The second example, what I would like to present here, what I am presenting here, is very old activity. And for example, this activity was connected to my interest to antiferromagnets and to derivation of sigma model equation. It's the dynamics of domino wall in canted antiferromagnet. Concretely, most of experiments were done for octoferrites, and as well for many of them were done for yttrium octoferrites. Yttrium octoferrite is very nice magnetic crystal. It is nice because it have extremely weak tamping, extremely small value of Gilbert constant. This value is like 10 is minus 4, as well as for high quality samples of yttrium iron garnet. And this is the same model object as yttrium iron garnet. Because yttrium is iron in a state and the dissipation is completely very, very weak. And for this material, you can present some samples, and a group of Professor Mikhail Chotkin in Moscow State University in late 70s, started to investigate dynamics of the domino. As well, this yttrium octoferrite, as well as many other octoferrites at room temperature, are canted antiferromagnets. You have finite, small but finite magnetic moment. And for this reason, you can do with this domino wall the same as the people are doing if domino wall is yttrium in ferromagnets. And this experiment demonstrates, this is the experimental points. This 20 kilometers per second, here I keep C as we wrote in our first argument. C, this phase velocity of speed waves, this characteristic velocity, for the ferrite, it's 20 kilometers per second. You can see a theoretical curve, which can be found on the ground of sigma model. And you have can find experimental points. Here you have some derivation, deviation from the theory, but it's high field enough. And what is important to demonstrate here, just for understanding of the physical picture. Here you have two anomalies, 4.5 kilometers per second and 6 kilometers per second. It's sound velocity. This motion of the dominant ball is very fast, and this is supersonic. 20 kilometers per second is 3 times higher what the speed of longitudinal sound. And near this anomalies, you have some indecent effects of Cherenkov radiation of phonons, which produce some additional contribution to the viscous force acting on the dominant wall. And this is also interesting physics here. Also interesting physics here is some review article. And the last part, the last example of high speed, high frequency, high everything motion of spin in antiferal magnet is the magnet speed, the speed of magnets. In principle, speed of, so let me see how to start with that. In principle, speed of magnets can be of exchange value. If you have, if you are inside brilliant zone, somewhere in the brilliant zone, in the center of, not in the center of the brilliant zone, but near the, somewhere in the brilliant zone. In principle, the frequency can be of exchange order of magnitude, and speed can be of the order of magnitude. But antiferromagnets are unique materials because their linear dispersion relation. You see this dispersion relation for antiferromagnetic magnets. This linear dispersion relation is started as quite small k. It's easy to find group velocity here. And you can see what if this k multiplied by magnet characteristic velocity Vm introduced before, you will see what if this quantity is of the order of omega zero of the antiferromagnetic resonance frequency, you will have some group velocity of magnets like exchange frequency. Here I just wrote square root from 2 just for accuracy. So for small enough values of the wave for antiferromagnet, you have very high velocity. Common to this maximal velocity, which is 20 kilometers per second for ferromagnet. For ferromagnet, situation is different. This is some kind of dispersion relation for ferromagnet. You know what, here is some, say, gap as well. Gap is smaller, but I don't pay attention on that. And then you have parabolic dispersion, like is present here, parabolic dispersion. And if you calculate the velocity, you can see what in order to get exchange velocity, like omega exchange multiplied by lattice constant, you have to be somewhere in the far from the center of the brilliant zone. You have to have small wave vectors. And small wave vectors, large wave vectors, small wavelengths. So it's like 1 over k, the k is lattice constant. So for antiferromagnet, we can expect what is reasonably small value of k, you can get fast motion of the magnets. So it's nice for magnetics. And there is, the problem is how to excite this magnet. And recently, it was nice experiment done by my colleagues. And this nice experiments solve this problem. how the antenna to excite some finite k vectors, you have to have some non-uniformity. And this uniformity in this experiment was created as the following way. The pump was used in the near this charge transfer transition, again in ortoferrite, and again in dysprosium ortoferrite. Charge transfer transition, if you put this ultraviolet pump, this energy stay in small region like 50 nanometers in the sample. So you have highly non-uniform initial deviation of spin from the ground state. And how we can watch for magnons, for propagating magnons? It was, this problem was solved in the following way. It has been used two kind of pump, or excuse me, probe. A transmission probe and reflection probe. And if you have transmission, you are measuring this, this ortoferrite is transparent. You are measuring some mean oscillation, mean value of the spin oscillation. So we cannot see short waves, spin waves. You have some uniform oscillation. And this is what is seen, some uniform oscillation with quite low frequency. But reflection, if you are doing reflection, you can, in principle, have some reflection, some break reflection from the propagating spin. And this break reflection, you can watch for this or that propagating magnon by change the probe wavelength. Here is transparency window from 600 to 800 nanometers. And this is what they can see, experimentalist can see. So in this break reflection, you can see what the frequency is much higher. And this is what the same data present and put it on this dispersion relation. So if they use this probe 600-800 nanometers, they appear to be here. And this is, it's very high velocity of propagation spin waves. And this is sound velocity, so the spin waves are propagating with supersound velocity. And this is some theoretical picture. Unfortunately, now we have no way to see such a picture, to present such a picture. It's necessary to have a lot of different detectors and so on, so we have no idea how to do that. But we can write down theoretical solution of this Landau, sigma model equation, just include some perturbation in near the edge of the system and see what happened. And what happened here? If t is equal to zero, you have some small perturbation here. It's the initial result of the action of this ultraviolet pulse. It's localized in a small distance, like 50 nanometers. And then you have a propagation. You can solve this equation, and this then they make the graph with some numerical work with integrals with solution. And you will see what a very well seen light cone, which is common to relativistic field theory or relativistic mechanics, is formed here. This is again this characteristic velocity, so in principle we can expect even much faster propagation, but unfortunately the way what we are having now with this break reflection and so on not allow us to see, for example, propagation with higher velocity. They are seen in this picture, but we cannot see them in the experiment. And this is what my colleagues is continue to think, to work, and so on. So thank you for your attention. This is what I wanted to say today. And now please ask questions.
Right. Thanks a lot for this very insightful lecture. And if there are any questions, I have not seen any yet. I will just maybe allow Sumit to ask his question. Yes, I think you can directly ask.
Yep. Thank you for this wonderful talk. Hello. I have a question regarding when you introduce this relativistic covariance or Lorentz invariance for the magnetic system. So what is the source of this emergent invariance? Is it the property of the underlying magnetic system or the LLG dynamics?
it's a good question. What is the reason for? It's not relativistic, of course.
Of course.
It looks like relativistic.
Yep.
And you understand, of course, what if you have some equation with second time derivative and second space derivative, you can combine them in some relativistic manner. Uh-huh. What's important for anti-ferromagnet? Let me show you. What is important for anti-ferromagnet? What this linear path, this relativistic part, is extended for large part of the brilliant zone.
Okay.
For example, if you write down some equation for optical photons, like, mm-hmm. you will have something like that. In the beginning, it will be as well relativistic, but not only in the beginning. But here, for anti-ferromagnet, the applicability of this linear dispersion relation, which is the part of this relativistic motion, is extended for almost all the brilliant zone. It's limited only by exchanging
direction.
So this, you see what I have here, some small tail to fit the brilliant zone and this known theorem. So it's formal relativistic equation. Mm-hmm. And if you will use the same formal relativistic analogy for, say, nonlinear optical photons, you will have very narrow field of applicability.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. If there are no other questions, maybe I will proceed and ask one. I was wondering, since you showed the high-speed propagation of magnets and antiferromagnets, and many people are working on actively modifying antiferromagnetic state at preferably very fast timescales, or terahertz timescales. And there are several approaches to do that, and one of them is to modify the antiferromagnetic state with a terahertz pulse of high amplitude of several hundreds of millitesla. And my question from just a more primitive view of an experimentalist is, how would that be implemented? So such a dynamic stimuli, how would it be implemented in a model? How could it be implemented?
I'm not sure to understand correctly your question. So you say it for some modification of antiferromagnetic state.
Exactly, yes.
By magnetic.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay. So I did not touch the problem of action of the magnetic. In principle, if you use magnetic field, you can modify the frequency of magnetons, you can modify the motion of domain walls, speed of magnetons, and all everything can be modified. But the point is, what is the value of magnetic field? As well, if to modify state of ferromagnet, you have to have magnetic field of the order of anisotropy.
Mm-hmm.
Shape anisotropy, for example, this 4 pi MS, sorry for Gauss system, or anisotropy field as itself, which is some FU Killer state and so on. for antiferromagnet, it is not the case. For antiferromagnet, to modify the state, you have to have higher magnetic fields.
Mm-hmm.
For example, a well-known spin flop transition is a modification of antiferromagnetic state. You can apply magnetic field along the easy axis. You have this magnetic moments. You apply field. Then this, it will be jumped, and you will have some contact, quasi easy plane state of the magnetic moment of sublattices. But to do this, you have to have spin flop field, which again is square root from exchange and anisotropy. So it is not Kilaerstedt, it's Hagrid.
If one would consider that the antiferromagnet could be brought in a different state by another, to say, static stimulus. So, for example, one would bias the antiferromagnet with a high static magnetic field such that it comes close to a spin flop or spin flip transition. Then I think it would be much easier to modify it on top with a dynamic stimuli. Is that correct?
Well, first of all, you say it's spin flip. I say it's spin flop.
Yes, yes.
I had no time to discuss the behavior of antiferromagnet under an action of magnetic field, but there is two transitions, which are, traditionally called spin flop. This is what I demonstrated.
Mm-hmm.
It's like 100 kilohertz, okay, roughly speaking. And spin flip. Spin flip is closing of sublattices. You have to apply exchange magnetic. So for spin flip, it is not the case. Concerning spin flop, yes, I can modify the state of antiferromagnet. I can reduce the frequency or enhance the frequency. I can do many things by application of the magnetic. But again, to be important to have some real changes in antiferromagnet, you have to have very high magnetic.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, again, 100 kilohertz. It's high. So for some material, it can be 80, 75, 100, 150, and so on. It's high magnetic. I can modify the state with application of this high magnetic field. I don't know what will be principal changes of, first of all, it will Lorentz invariance will disappear. If you apply magnetic field, again, I had no time to discuss it, it will broke the Lorentz invariance.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, the speed of the domain wall will be lower if you apply magnetic field. Lorentz invariance will be broken because you have some invariant. It will be broken, as well as it will be broken if you consider this Zelazinsky-Morey effect. It's also break Lorentz.
Mm-hmm.
This is not break. And this is breaking. So, for this reason, Lorentz invariance will be broken. Speed of solitons can be lower than this Vm, or can stay equal to Vm. It's for different directions of the field, it's different. Results. It was I discussed it long ago. So, maybe you can ask more concretely what you are expecting from this the magnons, the solitons, domain walls, and so on. What you are wanting to have by application of the magnetic field. Mm-hmm.
In principle, that already answered the initial question, so I would like to thank you for it. But maybe, if I may, on top of that ask, so if I would be interested in a, say, a magnon mold in a specific material, we could consider any of the dielectric fluorides, this approachable with terahertz fields at the order, at the same order. And I would like to modify that state. So an example, I would like to change the antiferromagnetic vector in the system. I think once there is a bias of magnetic field, I can do that much easier with a dynamic oscillating terahertz field. And that was the initial question, and I think it's already solved for me.
Well, if you have some uniaxial magnet, like you said, magnetic fluorides, for example, manganese fluoride, and if you apply magnetic field along the easy axis, you will have some splitting of the mm-hmm. One is going up, one is going down till the spin flop field. as I remember, it's something like 70 or 80 kilohertz. Then it will be spin flop, and this mode will go upstairs again. If it's what you are looking for, it's okay. I remember recently it was some articles, experimental articles, and the people use some thin films of chromium oxide and probably manganese fluoride. And they use magnetic field to make these frequencies lower. They had an experiment with some excitation of spin dynamics in this film plate of this antiferromagnet, which was connected to platinum or some other heavy metals, to see this antiferromagnetic response. And to have frequency lower, because they probably had some limits. Mm-hmm. You know this article. One was in Nature and one was in Science. One was with manganese fluoride. They apply strong magnetic field just to make the frequency lower and to have the possibility of resonance excitation of this magnet, of the spin oscillations. So it can be done. Can be done by application of the magnetic field. But simultaneously, you can do that much more easy way if you will use something like, say, ortoferrites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Usually for yttrium ortoferrite, the lowest frequency of antiferromagnetic resonance is 400 gigahertz, or 4 terahertz. Low frequency is 4, and higher is 6. But for dysprosium ortoferrite, which was used for this magnetic propagation experiment, near this Morin transition, this frequency is as low as 100 or something. Gigahertz, let me see. 100 and something. Oh, no. 200. Mm-hmm. 200. So it's much lower than 400. And in principle, you can even have a low frequency. Just go into nearby this reorientation transition. In principle, you can get 100, 150 gig by approaching this spin orientation transition. It's more easy than the magnetic field.
Oh, that's certainly true.
But also magnetic field can be used.
Mm-hmm.
And the standard situation, what if you apply magnetic field for easy axial antiferromagnet, easy axial, you will have, instead of two linearly polarized magnon, you have circularly polarized, and two different circular polarizations have a different frequencies. there is a splitting, linear magnetic field, this kind of splitting. This one goes downstairs, one goes upstairs.
All right. Thanks a lot for the excellent explanation. I think there are no more questions as far as I can see. I will also check in Q&A. No. So I would like to ask you, thank you. For the talk again. It was very, as I said, insightful also for me as an experimentalist. And I would end the session now.
Thank you.